Okay, students, test level webinar on
yes,
innovation, sure. Exploration and technology. In understanding an explained role organized by the Department of
Good morning to all of you.
In association yes. with Inviham Quality Assurance our Women's College. Test level
on behalf of the organizing committee,
innovation, now, exploration I would like to request Dr. Shima Banerjee. Principal,
organized by
Women's College,
the Department of
Geography,
Patron,
Association with the Internal Quality
to deliver
her
welcome address
and
inaugural
on behalf of the organizing committee.
Now,
kindly initiate
like
the webinar by your
senior management
principal,
Hubli
Women's College, and Patron.
Good morning, friends.
Of the
on behalf of the Hubli Women's College, I cordially welcome all of you to the one listed level webinar organized by the Department of Geography of Hubli Women's College. The topic of discussion is innovation, exploration, and technology in understanding.
Thank you, Shoumita.
We are fortunate
enough
to get
on behalf of the
Hubli
Women's
College
of the
I cordially welcome all of you
one from the Department
of
Environment
webinar
organized
and the other from
the
Geography
of
Geography. Later on they will be introduced by any teacher of the department. We know that geography is a field of science devoted to the study of lands, features, inhabitants and phenomena of the earth and planets. Geography is a science which connects living beings, especially human, with physical science. Today, we will try to move from a world of fantasy, a voyage of white continent, to a world of hardcore reality of application of geospatial technologies to describe the range of modern tools contributing to the geographic mapping and analysis of the earth and surrounding of human societies and environment. It also examines how human culture interacts with the natural environment and the way that locations and places can have an impact on people and change over time. Please, Shyamalina, IQSA coordinator of Hubli Women's College.
Thank you, ma'am, for your messages that always encourage us to do better or to improve ourselves. Now, I would like to request Dr. Shyamalina Goswami, Coordinator, Internal Quality Assurance Cell, and also our beloved head, beloved and respected head to the Department of Geography, Hubli Women's College, as well as the convener of the webinar to deliver her keynote address. Ma'am, I also requesting you to introduce our first resource person and to share a few words about him and commence our first invited lecture. Ma'am.
Ma'am, I think connection problem in audio device. So please plug.
Okay.
Ma'am, it's up to you.
Thank you so much.
Yes, madam. Yes.
And thank you, Principal Madam, for such a inaugural speech at the beginning of the today's webinar on innovation, exploration, and technology in understanding unexplained realm. Realm is the largest logical regions into which we can divide the whole world. Realm is synthesis of a composite of cultural, economic, historical, political, and appropriate environmental features. Antarctica is the fifth largest continent, bigger than Europe and Australia, and is the driest, coldest, and windiest. It is a continent which remains covered with snow and thick ice sheets all year round. Hence, it is known as the White Continent. The Great White Continent is made up of 90% of the world's ice and 70% of the world's fresh water. The frozen southern continent wasn't spotted until 1820. At the beginning of the 20th century, two groups of explorers set out across the desolate Antarctic landscape in a race to walk where no man had walked before. One team was led by Norwegian explorer Roald Amundsen and the other by English naval officer Robert Scott. A search party found Scott and his two remaining companions inside their sleeping bags in a small tent on the ice. There is so much we don't know about all aspects of Antarctic research. I think in part it is the exploratory nature of Antarctic science that makes it so exciting for students and researchers. Now, I would like to introduce today's eminent speaker, Dr. Punurbashu Chowdhury. His topic is A Voyage to White Continent. Dr. Punurbashu Chowdhury has pursued his PhD from University of Kollani, India, and postdoctoral from University of Sydney, Australia. He has vast teaching experience of 17 years. Presently, Dr. Punurbashu Chowdhury is assistant professor in Department of Environmental Science, University of Calcutta. His specialization is in environmental biology and pollution management. And research interests includes mangrove ecology and bioprospecting, air pollution and climate change, green chemistry, geochemistry, geoinformatics, Arctic and Antarctic environment. I am requesting all the participants to mute their microphone. Please make it possible, mute all of the participants' microphone. He has given research guidance to many, of which four have been awarded PhD. Number of researchers still pursuing is three, and he has guided 16 dissertation papers in the PG level. He has undertaken 17 projects, of which 10 has been completed, ongoing 5, and one has been sanctioned and one is on the process. Funded by UGC DAE, Inter University Accelerator Center, WWF India, DST, Government of West Bengal, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. Dr. Chowdhury has published more than 60 research papers in the reputed national and international journals. Two books have been published by him. He has attended many conferences and seminars and delivered lecture in 45 of such different fields. He has membership in Indian Science Congress Association and Indian Institute for Nature and Environment Study. He has achieved lots of awards from his UG level. In UG level, he received Vidyasagar College Centenary Scholarship for securing highest marks in the undergraduate examination, Obhinandro Guha Life Science Endowment for securing highest mark among all life science subjects in the undergraduate level, national scholarship from Ministry of Human Resource and Development, Government of India, for good performance in undergraduate studies. He received certificate of merit for securing first class first position in PG examination from University of Poland. He is a member 39th Indian expedition to Antarctica, Ministry of Earth Science, Government of India. Recipient of Endeavour Award of Government of Australia in 2012 for postdoctoral research. Recipient of DST ACRB, that is Science and Engineering Research Board, Fast Track Young Investigator Fund 2013. Recipient of Science Academics Summer Research Fellowship at School of Environmental Science, JNU. Appointed, he is appointed as Australian Award Ambassador in India by Government of Australia 2014. Recipient of Shastri Indo-Canadian Fellowship 2018 to participate basis Sarb Arctic expedition in the CCGS Amundsen to study the impact of climate change on polar environment. He is engaged in many notable activities like in environmental conservation activism, nature photography, and adventure sports. So we have with us most eminent speaker, Dr. Punor Basu Choudhury. And now over to Dr. Punor Basu Choudhury to deliver his talk on today's topic. Thank you, Dr. Punor Basu Choudhury, a voyage to white continent. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Shyamalina ji. It's my privilege to be here in the webinar. And I'll start my lecture by sharing the screen. Yes, can you hear me properly?
Yes, sir. You are audible, yes, perfectly audible.
Can you see the screen properly?
Yes, yes. Yes, Punabashu. Okay. It's okay.
A very good morning to all of the participants. And first of all, I convey my gratitude to Department of Geography, Hooghly Women's College, for giving me the opportunity to share some of my experience with our beloved students. The topic of today's webinar is innovation, exploration, and technology in understanding unexplained realm. I'll focus on the second keyword, exploration. Really, when Shyamalinandi was explaining the background of Antarctica, then I was thinking about those days I spent there. To begin with, yes, it is the fifth largest continent and one of the seven continents. Why it is white? Why it is frozen? Among the unique habitats, like tropical rainforest, temperate forest, grassland, desert, savanna, freshwater, marine water system, ice is a unique habitat, which one is beyond our eyes. We can see this ice cover habitat every time because we live in the tropics. But the ice world is known as cryosphere. The cryosphere covers the ice caps, glaciers, snow, permafrost, frozen lake and rivers, floating sea ice, iceberg, ice shelf, ice sheet, which covers a huge landmass. These are the part of the cryosphere. And the land where all the components are visible is the frozen continent Antarctica. For studying this cryosphere, Antarctica is a really ideal dreamland for research. For a long, long back, Shyamalina, they already told a background history. So it initiated 200 years back. Lots of explorers tried to reach the Arctic Circle. To reach the South Pole was a dream at that time. There was a tussle between the Norwegian group and the British group. Only few days in gap, Amundsen and Scott reached the pole. The middle picture was the very famous picture where Amundsen with his four followers reached the real true north, the South Pole. Amundsen is the person who has touched both the poles, South and North Pole. This is a very interesting man. However, the next picture was about Scott. Amundsen and Scott is the two names who are associated with the invention of the frozen continent, particularly the South Pole. There are lots of expedition and lots of countries right now. 42 countries are doing work in the Antarctic region. These are the location of different countries. Many countries have multiple stations. And at the center, the South Pole, there's the only station, US station, name of both Amundsen and Scott, very famous station, Amundsen Scott Station. And we are having two stations. One is here, Maitreyi, another is here at Bharati. Previously, we had the station called Dakshin Gangotri in this point. It was the first research station set by Indian expedition team. And India started Antarctic program in 1981 with the leadership of Soed Kashim. Many of you are aware about his name. It was the ship Polar Circle which took Indian members to Antarctica. And this one is the first research station, Dakshin Gangotri, which is not now existing. It is now under ice. And I must say about the name of Sudipta Sengupta was the first lady to be take part in Antarctic expedition, the third expedition. There was two ladies, one from West Bengal and another from Goa. So two participants in the third expedition. And Sudipta Sengupta popularized Antarctica by his book after returning back. He participated twice, third and ninth expedition. After coming back, she wrote a very beautiful book which make Antarctica so popular among the Bengali population. The book was in Bengali. There are so many books. Kashims have also written a book on Antarctica. But from 81 to 2020, so this 39 years, we are having several expeditions, 39 expeditions, each year one expedition. And the journey from Kolkata to participate in Antarctic program was not so easy. Our endeavor started 3 years back, 2017. We applied for a program for 37th expedition, but unfortunately, our program was not selected. The review committee put some queries and our project was not selected. Again, I applied in 2019. That time, I had to go to National Center for Polar and Ocean Research. There, I had to give the presentation in front of almost 15 reviewers, scientists and researchers who were working in Antarctica. They reviewed our program. And after lots of screening and lots of questions, our program was selected. And the selection was the provisional because after the academic selection, the next part was the physical examination. If we qualify the physical examination, then we will go for the third layer of screening, that was physical fitness. Well, for the medical fitness screening, we have to report at All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. And after qualifying, there were lots of, almost 6 days we have to spend for medical examination. And after qualifying, we had to report at the Himalayan Training Center of ITBP at Auli, Uttarakhand. It was a very picturesque landscape, the training institute. You can see from the picture on the foothill of the Himalayas, we had the base camp training. And our trainers was army commander trainers. It was very skilled. And in screen, you can see Commander Sunil Singh was giving instruction about safety course. Along with this safety, we have to go for rigorous mountaineering and rock climbing techniques, lots of safety measures, because it was very necessary during our field work at Antarctica. Then there was a glacier acclimatization. To acclimatize ourselves with the snow and ice. It was near Mana village, the Indo-Tibet border region. It was very interesting training. After long, almost 20 days we have to spend there. And then we qualified for the main expedition. We were graduated by the army officers in their institute. It was a very memorable day for us, because we were finally selected for the expedition. Next part was the main expedition. So 39 Indian Antarctic program having three components, Maitreyi, Voyage and Bharti. And I was selected for Voyage. Our responsibility was to take the ship from South Africa to both the stations, Maitreyi and Bharti. So this one is Maitreyi and this one is Bharti. For that, we start leave Kolkata on 15th of December 2019. After leaving, we have to report at NCPU at Goa for our induction program. In the induction program, we were distributed the polar clothing, which were necessary for our expedition duration, special type of clothing we have to collect from there. And there we got a farewell by the ministry, farewell party by the Ministry of Earth Science. And we have bought this patch for expedition. It's the 39 Indian scientific expedition. My name, we got patch. Next was another training of marine safety, fire, and other equipment use. It was in Goa also. So in that training, we learned a lot about situation handling, hard situation which may arise during our voyage. It was a very specialized training. And after that training, we set our journey. Started from Goa. We reached Cape Town. First, we had its halt at Ethiopia. change the flight to Ethiopia, and from Ethiopia we take a Boeing fly over all the interesting, very interesting geographical places like Masai Mara, Serengeti, fly over Kilimanjaro, Gobi Desert, and we reach Cape Town. That was a South African experience, was a big story. I am not discussing about, because it is a totally different story. My experience in South Africa, crossing worst South African terrains, wild region. From Cape Town, our journey initiated. And right now we are at Cape Town Port. This is our ship, Vasily Globulin, which took us to Antarctica. Our journey started in the night of 24th December from Cape Town Port. This is the tugboat guided us from Cape Town Port to Atlantic Ocean. So the tugboat will not go up to the Atlantic Ocean. It will cross the port area, and there are light signals, and in the skyline you can see the city of Cape Town. Gradually we leave the port, and on the next morning we started our journey through Atlantic Ocean. And this point we have, just for your interest, that is Cape of Good Hope. We learned about childhood days geography book. Had also opportunity to visit that Cape of Good Hope while staying in South Africa. That was an amazing experience. But when starting the journey, we all are fear about the name of the four cycles. The first one, the roaring 40s, furious 50s, screaming 60s, and then the Antarctic. So roaring 40s was the name we know from our geography books in school lives. While crossing this roaring 40, it was a really great challenge. And we felt that proverb which was told about that below 40 degrees south there is no law, and below 50 degrees south there is no God. That is old sailor's saying. So it was really very, very challenging to cross this roaring 40s, furious 50s, and screaming 60s. The sea was really very rough. But the beauty was there sometimes with bad weather, the large rainbow, beautiful colors with our sampling in every degree latitude. We took samples for our study. I was studying the effect of and the pathways of plastic, how it is polluting the ocean and how it is migrating to Antarctic. That was my objective to study in this program. And the sea was very rough. You can see from this picture that the splashing of the waves, the rolling and pitching. And let us see what was inside the ship, because it was a very interesting to know about the ship. This one is the most important place. It's called bridge, from where the ship is being controlled. And this is the rudder, which helps captain and other crew members to guide the ship. This is the monkey deck, from where rudder and other equipment are operated. It's the highest point of the ship. It's for our boardroom, where meetings are there. This is Javed Beg Sahab. He is the director of Indian Antarctic Program. This year, he was with us in the voyage. Has a vast experience. He visited Antarctica more than 9 times. And he was member of Indian South Pole Expedition. However, this was our captain and chief engineer of the ship, the right-hand picture. And all about our kitchen. It's a very interesting kitchen where no fire is allowed. In ship kitchen, you have to cook on hot plate. And every member has to give galley duty. There was a duty roster, and we have to do all the work along with cooking, preparing food, cleaning, and other works, which are known as the galley duty. So he was Mithilesh, our chef of the ship, and we have to assist him on a daily roster basis. There are different type of foods. We enjoyed Christmas. This dessert were prepared ourselves in the kitchen. This is our store where we store almost 1 year food for survival. This is inside the ship, the corridor. These are our cabin, which we converted to a small laboratory for our research work. These are our entertainment room. This is gymnasium. And we have to mention about the communication system. This is a one Iridium phone, and we had a quota of 6 minutes per month. Only 6 minutes we have communication type. You may finish it one call for a month, or you can make it fragmented. It was very difficult to manage the calls, because getting the line and to saying that I am okay, it almost took 40 to 45 seconds. Anyhow, we have to communicate with this system, and we have a group email, the one email ID for all the team members for any emergency. That was the communication system. The first sight of iceberg, the picture, from the picture you can see it was not very good picture, but I put this picture because it was a very memorable day. When the first iceberg was crossing the screaming 60s, we encountered this iceberg. Gradually, there was change. Ice shackles are forming the railing of the ships. Around the ship, sea ice are coming, the floating sea ice. Ice was all over the windows. Like this, we have set action cameras to record our movement, our activities. It was very good in cold condition also. And it's very helpful, because every time taking photographs in this cold temperature was not possible manually. So usually we put this type of camera for what is change happening, how the ship is moving. Time-lapse photography we did with this type of camera. And this is the close-up view of the iceberg, which are floating away. This was separated from the ice shelf, and then gradually floating away through the Southern Ocean. So, well, after crossing 60 degrees south, we have encountered these situations. And the first, we came down from the ship at Crown Bay. We had some assignment with the Belgian research station, and there we meet a legendary polar scientist who is, his picture is here, Alan Hubert, is chief scientist at Belgian research station, basically a mechanical engineer. But as I must say about his achievement, he's one who traversed both the South Pole and North Pole, not Antarctic and Arctic. He touched both the poles by walking. After Amundsen, very few personalities have this opportunity. But Alan was that man who took a sledge and traversed more than 5,000 kilometers in both the polar region to reach the poles. We had opportunity to meet him in this Crown Bay, and we had lots of sharing. We got many stories from him. He was with us for taking some cargo materials which were sent by Belgian government. Next, we sailed for Bharti, our research station at Lachenman Hill. contract with us. In Crown Bay, it was sea ice. We landed in sea ice. But this is Lashurman Hill, where our Indian research station is there. So it was the first sighting of land among the ice. The frozen continent is not always frozen. 3% of the continent, you can see this type of bare rocks coming out from the ice. And our station is situated in this rock. This is our beautiful station, Bharati. And in different times, Bharati looks different. When there is snow, it looks like this. When the Kulti Bay, the sea behind our station is known as Kulti Bay. When the Kulti Bay is not frozen, it looks like this. It's a very beautiful station, and I must say that we are very proud to have this very developed station among the 42 countries who have established their research station in Antarctica. Bharati is one of the most well-equipped research stations. I must say, students who are interested to work in this polar region are most welcome to work in this station. I'll show you the inside of the station. And for the students of geography and other interdisciplinary sciences students, there are lots of opportunity. If you have your own fellowship, NED-JRF or this type of fellowships, and you can think about going there. And in our research, early research career, we are not aware about that fact, that we may also, our students may also go to participate in this type of expeditions. Yes, it is possible. And this is inside of the station. And inside, you will not feel that you are in Antarctica. It's like a five-star hotel. The inside of the station is like that. It is our lounge. It is the dining. Lots of foods. We have to cook all the foods. And everything was done by self. There was no helping hand. We are the helping hands. We have to prepare. We have to make all the things. And the expedition member from another research station, from Russian station, Australian station, Chinese station, they come. This picture was taken on our Republic Day, 26th January. Scientists from different stations visited our Bharati, and we had lunch together, and it's a very good time. This is our dining, very neat and clean. Different type of foods. This variety of foods, you won't imagine how lavishly we can live there. Very, very good facilities. This part, our cabin. Two of our members can stay in this berth, upper berth and lower berth. And this corridor, beside this corridor, there are two rows of rooms. This is the lounge where we can sit and see the outside. Very beautiful scenic beauty observed through this lounge. There are some duties like galley duty. This is a cleaning duty. After snowfall, we have to clean the roofs. Otherwise, it may damage the station. So the team members have to take safety equipments to do all this work in the stations. And these are the research laboratories. This is the laboratory where I work. And I must say that that we read about that 6 month day and 6 month night in Arctic and Antarctic region. Not exactly 6 months. The 6 month is applicable in the south and north pole. But in Antarctica, the day and night cycle is very, very peculiar. And the picture was taken on 21st January at 2 a.m. in the night, and you can see sunlight outside. So it was the day period where we were in Bharati. These are the other laboratories, and here a very interesting experiment is going on. He is Professor Rajayutin Khan from Mumbai IIT. He had a study on the mental ability of the scientists, how it is affected by the stress environment in Antarctica. So he was a psychologist, and he did a very unique study on our brain performance. And the program is still going on. These are the other laboratories. This one is the meteorology lab. This one is meteorology lab. This one is the IIG, Indian Institute of Geomagnetism, other lab. These two labs are by BARC, Bharat Atomic Research Center. They do different radiation type of studies. In the probe and sensors are set outside. The controller and the data taking facilities labs are inside the station. I'll show the outside facilities also. So these are the biology labs. There are very good biology labs with microbiology, zoology, botany, and lots of other facilities like incubation, sterilization. Who are interested in biological work, they can do there in these laboratories. There are chemical labs also having UV visible spectrophotometer, water and soil analysis kits and soil analysis probes are available there. There are lots of other sonicator, centrifuge, rock cutting instrument for petrological study. There is a very good laboratory for petrological studies for geologists and geographers. They can use it. So outdoor studies, this one is very important observation of the IMD. They study the greenhouse gases along with ozone hole detection, ozone hole monitoring through this balloon. This balloon carries a probe and it can record. The geography students are aware about the weather balloon. It's a type of weather balloon, but having some specified sensors. It is having an ozone monitoring sensor. Ozone monitoring sensor, which can give thickness of ozone in the Antarctic region, because all of we are aware about that the thinning of ozone layer is happening over Antarctic region. To monitor this, we are having a 15-day interval monitoring programs. There are scope to trying alternate energies beside power generation by generators. There are some alternative power generations like wind, because Antarctica is the windiest place. Very hard, chill wind is there. To utilize this wind, these windmills are there. So this is our ship, and from ship, we sometimes walk to the frozen sea to our stations. And from ship, helicopter carries the ration and other materials for Bharti station, because ship is very nearer. Taking the materials from ship, the helicopter is used. There are two helicopters. The smaller one usually is used for sampling purpose, and we are taking water sampling using an skin sampler. Lake sampling process is happening. To a frozen lake, we are collecting samples using the helicopter. This is an skin sampler. Very interesting way to collect sample. These are the inland frozen lakes, and the ocean, sometimes it melts, and after melting, crystal clear water. You can see up to the bottom, there is no suspended particulate matter. For different type of geochronological study, we usually take that lake sediment cores, because here, many of the students were having sedimentology in their course. To understand the paleo environment, these sediment cores are very important. And throughout Antarctica, several organizations is studying the geochronology to make a clear environmental history. These are ice caps formed inside the glacier by the melting of ice. All of we are aware about sea ice melting due to climate change. The triggering factor increased carbon dioxide by anthropogenic activities, and as a result, Earth's average temperature is increasing. There are blizzards. Many times we have encountered blizzard, it's been normal phenomenon. And during blizzard, we have to aware about the wind chill factor. So as wind blows, temperature goes down. If the mercury temperature was minus 10 and there was a wind of 50 knots, the temperature will fall down to minus 36. Though the mercury temperature is minus 10, due to wind, it will go down to minus 36. So this is known as the wind chill factor. So we have to take proper precaution when there are wind, because along with temperature, the high wind speed will increase the danger of frostbite. We have to take care of that. And there are this type of hidden dangers. There are crevasses. If we walk through the soft ice bridges, they are not very stable sometimes. If we fall through this is very small crevasses, very small. There are crevasses of 80 feet, 90 feet long crevasses up there. So we have to take very, very much precaution while moving. Now it is time to move from Bharti. We have spent more than a month in Bharti, and we started our journey from Bharti to Maitri, our another research station. And when we started our journey, it was a drone shot of our ship in Quilty Bay. It was frozen at the time. And when we started our journey in February, we can have a little dark phase, short evening type light. You can see from the picture, it is night, 8:35 p.m. and it is looking like evening light up there. So we started towards Maitreyi, to the open sea, but the ice snowfall was continuing. Hello? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yes. Yes.
You are audible.
There was some problem in the slide.
Okay, sir.
So, which slide you have seen the last?
The on the ship. It is
sir, frozen. Slide number 72. Sir, slide number 72.
Slide number 72.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
How much time I am have till I'm 11:15? Up to.
Okay, no problem. You carry on, please.
Okay.
Very interesting.
So, we are passing through India Bay. It was the region where our first expedition ship reached there. So we are going through that region, and it was powered with thick sea ice. Along with sea ice, there was a very unique type of ice which we are not aware at all about. It was known as pancake ice. It's ice frogs like fish scale. It floats in greasy ice, and gradually it is not solid. It is a semi-solid mass floating into a grease-like material. So this is a very unique habitat, that pancake ice in grease ice matrix. Anyhow, it was a new experience to encounter this type of sea covered with this ice. And sometimes we got some open sea with this rocky terrain, shadow and light, amazing landscape with lots of color of the ice. You can see the blue ice, different color reflected from the ice. It was amazing, beautiful colors. There are lots of this type of pictures. I'm just telling you, we reached India Bay and we moved there, but the mooring was very difficult. I'm showing you the moored ship, but it took 6 days to stabilize our ship because of high wind. It took 6 days to put this structure to make our ship stabilize. It was a great challenge there. And from there, our research station, Maitri, was 120 kilometers. So we have to fly. Six of the members, we got opportunity to work in this station. So we fly from ship to Maitri in end of February and reach there. The station is 30 years old station and entirely made by Indian technology. And the expedition members erected this structure, and it is maintained. The station is maintained by the team members of the expedition. No other specialized Maitri in Bharti. It was in German technology, and it was maintained by a group of engineers. But the Maitri station is maintained by the Indian researcher and the team members, which is Maitri during desert. You can see this is known as the weather shocks. This weather shock give you the a rough intensity and direction of wind. This is inside the station, and you can see it is very, very old infrastructure, but very neat and clean. Both the station, the members are taking responsibility every day. They have to do galley duty to clean the stations. This is the dining from our meeting lounge at Maitri. This is the Western lounge. This is the amusement room type of things. We do chatting with the music. We can read books because this is the glass windows are there. There's a very good view of the continental ice sheet from this lounge. We are having a very good library in both the stations. And I found very interesting books in the Maitri library. And there is a post office. Though nowadays it was not very functional, but for the persons who are interested in philatelic stamp collection, it was very important for them to get stamp from this post office. So this is a letter with lots of stamps on that. I posted this letter from Antarctic, this letter box. Eventually the letter came with our ship also. So, but there is a ritual, the Maitri, the post office. And this is our station member. It was the day of Holi. We are celebrating Holi inside. A small celebration was there. And in Maitri, the real hardship of Antarctica is felt, because in Bharti, it was like a five-star hotel. We can't understand what is going outside. But in Maitreyi, we have to stay outside the station. These are known as summer containers. In container gulote, we have to stay inside this container for entire period of staying there. The summer members are allotted inside these containers. And these are the huts. These huts are the basically the research laboratories inside these huts. And inside the container, this is look like this. There are some bed, a working table, and very small space for keeping our equipment and other things. The outside temperature is minus 15. The wind is going on. And the problem is that when we breathe out, it just crystallizes and forms ice around our nose. It was very difficult to manage. You can see that ice crystals are forming, and if we can't take proper management, it may cause frostbite. Anyhow, the frozen area around our station, and it is a very notorious place. An international group had initiated tourism there. It is away from our station, but these are their igloo resort. Is maintained by a UK-based company. They are taking tourists in the name of science operation. They are showing that they are taking out scientists, but actually they are taking a huge amount of money. You can't believe how much they are taking, a huge amount of money to take them, and for 4 or 5 days they are keeping the tourists there, and it was very offensive thing. Already there are reports against them. This time there was no tourist when we visited that spot. This is one of the most important lake of Antarctica, Lake Priyadarshini, named after our ex-prime minister. Priyadarshini is a 13 square kilometer lake encircling around Maitreyi station, and it was frozen at that time. The close-up of the ice, the ice crystal, the trapped air, and below the water, you can see the water is below the ice. So there are research facilities outside the stations. These are the laboratory for cosmology. These are the laboratory for upper atmospheric and tropospheric studies by National Physical Laboratory. These labs are maintained by IIG, Indian Institute of Geomagnetism. They are studying how the geomagnetic property, the magnetic pole is shifting. We all know about it. To study the shifting of the magnetic pole, there was some instruments to study there. A group of scientists is working there. We sometimes help them to their work, because we were very inquisitive about interdisciplinary work. Different groups are working in different aspects. So we shared each our experience and the instrument facilities. There are two labs where seismological experiments are going on, this Tamet and another is Tirumala. And the observatory is a weather monitoring, because we are having two permanent meteorological stations at Bharati and Maitreyi. Every day, 4 data are uploaded internationally for polar scientists. This is the inside of the meteorological labs. So this hut is known as Apple Hut of IMD. Inside the hut, you can see the instruments all are kept inside sleeping bag, because to maintain the temperature, outside temperature sometimes go beyond minus 60 degrees. To protect the equipments, these are the precautions. There are heaters, there are sleeping bags to keep the instrument in proper working condition. These are other two labs. These labs are made for aerosol study. How the aerosols are migrating from mainland to Antarctica. So these two labs are being set up there. There are accelerometers and other type of instruments which are continuously monitoring the particulate matter present in air. This one is a very interesting set up by SAC, Space Application Center. These are known as corner reflector. This corner reflector, because many of you are aware about satellite remote sensing. For satellite remote sensing, for calibrating some satellites, these corner reflectors are being used. So this year, they have established six this type of corner reflectors in different part of Antarctica. In Antarctica, there are many glaciers. This is one of the most famous glacier of Antarctica, Dakshin Gangotri Glacier. We are aware about Gangotri Glacier, which is the origin of Mother Ganges. This glacier is named after Gangotri, Dakshin Gangotri. And the first research station was made near this glacier and named after this glacier. This glacier, there are lots of studies being done on this glacier. One of the important type of study is the ice core study. Ice core study is a very important climate proxy. It's because the geographers, you are aware about the climate change, and to study the climate of the past, this is the archive. You can see air bubbles trapped inside the ice core. These air bubble are the air which trapped inside the ice core when the ice was formed. If the ice formed 1,000 years back, the air is of 1,000 years old. So to get an air of 1,000 years back, it is not possible in anywhere, and it is only archived in this ice core. So these are how the ice are melting. Along with Indian research stations, there are other country research stations. We have visited many of the research stations. The scientists from other research stations, as well as we, there are some exchange visit programs. So this one is the Russian research stations. Along our team members, we visited, interact with the Russian scientists there. So that's the Progress research station. We have visited the Chinese research station, Songshan, the Polar Research Institute of China. They are having four stations in Antarctica. We have visited one of them. There are some international observatories like this. This is a special observatory, astronomical observatory, specially made for aurora. They are having six cameras on the top of the observatory, and these are dedicated for aurora study. You know aurora, the southern light, very famous. This is the glacier studies, how the glacier is moving, how fast glacier is melting. They have studies, they have put some permanent stations there. Every year they monitor the movement and the thickness of the ice. They use DGPS to calculate the measurement. There are some plate tectonic studies are also there. In our station, there is a permanent plate tectonic study station where the minute change in the Antarctic plate, they are measuring the movement of the plate by using these permanent stations. Near that comet, I have shown you that laboratory comet. It was near that comet laboratory. This is GPR, ground penetrating radar study, to measure the thickness of the ice. So this is the GPS setup, and this is, you all know that the GPS, which is used to fixing the position, and this instrument measures the thickness of the ice. These are the vehicles used on ice. These are known as piston bully or the snow tractors. In Maitreyi, we are having 12 of these operational tractors. These are very useful vehicles because in Maitreyi, the entire ration and other logistic materials have to carry from ship on the ice shelf. So they have to move 120 kilometers on ice to take ration from the ship. They have to prepare convoy like this. Together, ship, they make a convoy. And these are some snow scooters which are used for local movement. Like this, for local movement, 2-3 people can move with these snow scooters. This is a very important vehicle working there. The snow tractor or the piston bully are made for the ice covered area, And these Arctic trucks are specialized for rocky terrain as well as the ice terrain. So for rapid movement, piston bully are a little bit slower. For rapid movement, it's very costly. This Arctic truck is very costly. We are having two Arctic trucks there. And the beauty of ice aircraft, it is very famous Ilyushin aircraft, which can able to land on ice. So they carry expedition members, rations, logistics from the mainland to Antarctica. There are some special points. This is Novo Air Base. This was a special area where this type of ALCI Ilyushin flight can land. And inside Antarctica, there are some small feeder flights like this. These are known as the feeder flights. This fly in between stations. In ship, we took almost 14 days from Bharti to Maitri. But this feeder flight will take 6 to 8 hours from one station to another station. Anyhow, now we are focusing on the life on the ice. This is one of the significant features which was discussed for the last few months. Scientists are very worried about this phenomenon. It's known as green ice formation. You are aware of, many of you may aware about this green ice formation, that the algae are growing on the ice, and this is a bad indicator of climate change. But the ice are growing and absorbing energy, which is known as bioalbedo. The bioalbedo is one of the factors which are causing melting of the surface of the ice. You can see the ice pools, which are generated by this algal growth. Algal growth are there in the freshwater lakes. There are algal mass flowing. There is no large vegetation beside this algae on the lake, planktonic algae and the macroalgae. Other type of vegetation is the lichen. There are different type of lichen, almost 272 type of lichen has been reported from there. There are few moss beds after melting of the ice. There are some moss beds are there. These moss beds are very unique ecosystem. There are lots of small insects like Columbola and other group of insects are found in this type of area. This is Antarctic krill, the base of Antarctic food chain. Many animals are dependent on this small prawn-like structure. This is very small prawn-like structure. Chingri macher moto dekhte choto choto creature. Take a bola hai krill. A krillero pore total Antarctic ecosystem is standing. There are lots of birds which are known as pelagic bird, which fly around the sea, not in the Antarctic mainland. So this is the largest flying bird, wandering albatross. And there are other pelagic birds, almost 30 pelagic birds. I am not going to the details. I will focus on the only four species which are observed in Antarctic mainland. One is this Wilson storm petrel, snow petrel. I have mentioned that WII, the picture taken by their scientists, they are continuously studying the bird and wildlife in Antarctica for the last 15 years. So this is southern polar squaw, the predator bird of Antarctica. The predator bird, they predate on petrel and penguins. So in very cold condition, they love water, and every day they bathe. Very interesting. The picture is taken. A small portion of Priyadarshini Lake was not frozen, and the squaw was bathing in that. We are having polar squaw ringing program. You can see the small ring. This is a geosynchronized ring. We can monitor the movement of these birds because the bird can fly up to 3,000 kilometers in the periphery of Antarctic region. So how much area they are covering for their food, this is important. And obviously, the famous penguin. we have encountered two types of penguins there, the Dreamland. This is Wheeler Island penguin rookery. I had chance to visit that rookery with the scientists who are working on the behavior of penguins. And these are some snapshots of the penguin rookeries. So these are the chicks. They're waiting for their parents who went to collect their food. These are the penguin parents. This is the pathway from the rookery to the sea. There's a fixed path. So they move to collect their food, and they collect their food from this beautiful place. It's one of the most beautiful places of Antarctica I've visited. It's really like heaven. And they're very friendly. If you kneel down in like them into the snow, they will come very near to you. They're very inquisitive. They're very friendly. And we had very good time with these penguins. Yes, the mother is feeding the penguins. The mother is taking krill from the ocean, and they chew it. And after half chewing, they feed the chicks with that pills. These are the emperor penguin. Yes, they're the real majestic view of the emperor penguins. A very close up view. They came very close to ours. It was taken in India Bay. There are some other places also. They visit in flocks, and when they move fast, they move like this. There are videos, but we'll not have time to share those videos. So these penguins move like very, very fast. They can move. In walking, it is slow, but when they want to move fast, they move on their belly. They are very good swimmers. Yes, you can see they are swimming. And this is a very memorable picture for me. Due to climate change, this penguin and other polar community, they're suffering of the habitat loss. Yes, this way, the icebergs are coming out, breaking apart from the main Antarctic icelands. Gradually, this fragmenting is happening, and the ice cover is melting and removing very fast, keeping the future of the penguins in a big, big question. So these are some other features. These are the crab-eating seals. Four types of seals are observed in Antarctica. This is one type. And this one is one of the most endangered species of the world. Only few hundred are left in this population. These are Antarctic fart seal. So it's a very extremely endangered animal. They are counting their days from extinction. There are lots of whales we have observed during our voyage, different type of whales. Here you can see the humpback. This one is the blue whale. This one is the next one is the very close up view of the minke whale during our expedition. And I will show you in the conclusion the beauty of the night. It was hardly believed that night sky can be like this. Yes, it is the night sky taken from Maitreyi. There we got complete darkness, and you can see how many stars are there. And this is the Milky Way galaxy. You can see the stars, and this is one of the memorable picture with the shooting star, because shooting star, the meteoroids are very important in Antarctic studies. Antarctica is a great archive of the meteors, and there are lots of meteors have been reported from Antarctica. There is a big project of Antarctic meteorite location mapping project, which are being done by different countries. And finally, I must say the most beautiful, the Southern Light, the Aurora Australis. Now, we are very lucky that as a summer member, the Aurora is for the winter members who spend a year in Antarctica. This is the gift for the winter members. But we are very lucky. Just 3 days before we leave Antarctica, we got this beautiful view of Aurora. From the picture, you can't realize how beautiful it may be. And this is a picture aurora with the Milky Way galaxy. There are lots of pictures. Just I'm showing you one. This one is the aurora above our station Maitri. There are some videos, but let me conclude that we are at the end. We are started our journey from India Bay. In our way, the large icebergs. These are the mountain-like structure is nothing but the icebergs. We got extreme bad weather, two cyclones while we are returning. That was a very horrible experience. It delayed our journey. We have to en route. 1,500 kilometer we have to deroute from our usual route for to avoid these cyclones. And gradually again, we reached Antarctic Ocean. And I must say about one of the experience we faced in 6th of February. It was declared as the hottest day in Antarctica. And there was the news was came like that, T-shirt weather in Antarctica. And it was that day 18.3, the highest temperature. Many of you have wrote about read about this news, but in Maitri and Bharti, it was not 18 degrees. In Bharti, that day I was in Bharti and it was nearly 7 degrees. That was too high for the stations. And we came out of the station without any polar gear. Like really, it was a t-shirt weather. And finally, we came to the African coast. And after reaching there, we came to know about what is happening in the world. That was the COVID-19 phenomena. We came to know about, first time we heard about the situation lockdown because our ship was detained outside the African coast due to the lockdown in South Africa. And that was a different story. After reaching there, we have to spend four times quarantine in different places. That was the South Africa famous tabletop mountain. It is one of the seven natural wonders of the world. Tabletop mountain is a unique habitat. So we reached South Africa and after spending a long time in South Africa because there was no flight at that time, we have to spend more than 40 days there, 3 or 4 days in the ship. Then we came to a quarantine center. That was our entire journey. From Cape Town to Crown Bay, it was 7,250 kilometers. But while returning back due to the cyclone, we have to traverse more than 8,430 kilometers. Entire journey was 19,000 kilometers. It was a huge, huge journey. But I'm concluding and acknowledging my fellow members. I was very proud to be a member and representing my country. Thankful to Ministry of Earth Science and CPO Government of India. Obviously, my university, University of Calcutta, for allowing me to participate this program and the other organizations, DST, UGC, DAE. And obviously, I have to mention about some other organizations who helped us for preparing sampling facility and the analytical facility. Like HVCS and HMRC Howrah, they have helped me a lot for preparing. And my students, my research students, who helped me to prepare all the materials to take there and planning my sampling. And obviously, Hooghly Women's College Authority for giving me this platform to share the opportunity with all of you. Thank you. And I think.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. We really enjoyed the voyage of White Continent through your presentation. You almost covered all our queries. Thank you once again, sir, for your nice presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sir, I have some questions. Sir, your. You have found some what kind of scientific experiment was done in Antarctica for combating the ozone layer depletion?
Ozone layer depletion, I have shown you that balloon carrying the ozone sond, it is covering up to 35 kilometers of the air column. Up to 35 kilometers of air column, each 100 meter it is taking one reading, and it is transmitting the reading through that transponder. I have shown you in the picture. The balloon is carrying the sensor, and for every 100 meter we are getting the ozone concentration along with the other gaseous pollutants, not pollutants, other gaseous components. So it's a very useful technique. And we are having some ozone sensors, fixed ozone sensors, to monitor ozone in both the stations. IMD is doing that.
Thank you, sir. We have one more question. What kind of seismological studies was taking place there?
In our station, I have not shown all the facilities. We are having a very sensitive seismograph in our station.
Yeah.
And it is a very specialized lab called Tirumala. In Tirumala lab, they have set the seismological stations, and that IIG, they are carrying out different experiments on the seismological aspects.
Yeah.
And the data are available if somebody want to have the access of the data, because the data are in the public domain. So if somebody is interested, they can write to the authority, to NCPR, the database, they can have access on that seismological data.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more question. You have already mentioned that you have used DGPS.
We have not, our team, yes.
Yes. So, sir, how much the accuracy level of DGPS there?
Right now, I can tell you the exact value, because the other members, they have used it. But I'm not sure about the precision, that value of the precision is, I can't tell you. But if somebody is really interested, then I can link them. The people who are doing this DGPS study, if somebody is really interested, they can keep in touch with me. I can put them communicated with the scientists who are doing this DGPS work.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay.
I would like to request Dr. Shaulina Goswami, HOD Department of Geography. Ma'am, you have any queries?
Nothing. I was astonished through a journey, so eloquent, informative presentation. Thank you, Punal Bushu.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Now, shall I go to the...
Yes.
Carry on, Shomita.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. Sir, please stay with us, because we are going to start our second technical session. Dr. Mafizul Haque from University Department of Geography, University of Calcutta, will deliver his lecture in the second technical session. Ma'am, kindly introduce him.
Okay, thank you, participants, for patience sharing. We have come to the second phase of today's theme, innovation, exploration, and technology in understanding unexplained realm. The second topic is application. Am I audible to all?
Yes, ma'am, audible.
Okay. The second topic is application of geoinformatics for vulnerability reduction in mountain and urban ecosystem. According to James, 1972, geography arose from two fundamental desires in human nature. Number one, to find out what lies over the next hill, that is to explore unknown places and report what we find. And number two, to know where we are, that is to navigate on the face of the earth. Technology is the devices and techniques employed by society to sustain its existence and improve its quality of life. Technology refers most often to tangible, practical objects, hardware and software that satisfy social definitions of usefulness. The integration of geographic technologies, such as the global positioning system and geographic information system, is creating an explosion of new real-time, real-world applications and research capabilities. The resultant dynamic space and time interactive research and management environments created by interactive GPS and GIS, among other technologies, place geography squarely at the forefront of advanced multidisciplinary research and modeling programs and have created core organization management tools that is called geographic management system that will dramatically change the way governments as businesses work in the decades ahead. Now, the topic application of geoinformatics for vulnerability reduction in mountain and urban ecosystem by Dr. Mofizul Haq. Let me introduce and say something about Dr. Mofizul Haq. He is a very young, most younger scientist geographer, born in 1981, was awarded PG degree in geography and environment management from Vidyasagar University, Midnapur in the year 2004. Before junior research fellow, UGC funded in 2008 at the Department of Geography, University of Calcutta. He served in the Department of Geography, University of Kalyani, Nodia as a cartographer. He was an assistant professor in the Department of Geography, Alia University, Kolkata from 2012 to 2015. After awarded the PhD degree in 2014 from the University of Calcutta, he joined in the Department of Geography, University of Calcutta, as an assistant professor. So thank you Dr. Mofizul Haq, and I'm requesting you to please participate. And I further want to mention that his area of inclination is change science, mainly the application of geospatial technology on urban landscape, microclimate, habitat analysis, urban environment, and paleoclimate study. He was also engaged with Presidency University, Kolkata, Kaji Nojrul University, Asansol, and Jadavpur University, Kolkata as a guest teacher. He completed ISRO-sponsored certificate course from IIRS, Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, Dehradun, on RS and GIS application on geosciences in 2019. Dr. Haq has published more than 25 research papers in the reputed national and international journals as well as annals, and delivered a lot of research articles in the seminars, conferences, and Congress. He was engaged in the training program of SIP, that is State Institute of Panchayat and Rural Development, Kalyani, Government of West Bengal, during March to June 2015. Currently, he is coordinator of IIRS Outreach Program, ISRO at Department of Geography, University of Kolkata. Now I'm requesting, and now it is over to Dr. Hawk. Please, Dr. Hawk.
Thank you, ma'am. And I would like to thank you, the organizing committee, Department of Geography, Hooghly Women's College, for inviting me in such a good introduction session. And it is mainly webinar session. And at first, I would also like to hats off our teacher, Punar Bosu Chaudhary, for delivering such nice and interesting presentation for an unknown world. And I'm also happy to see our Punar Bosu sir after a long break. Now, I would
thank
like...
Thank you. Thank you, Mafizul. I'm really glad that you are here. And you were in my presentation, you saw the presentation. I mean, really, it's a pleasure for me. Thank you, Mafi. Thank you. Yeah. Because he's a very good friend of mine. And long time we haven't met. Just we are meeting here in this web platform. Thank you, Mafizul. You carry on, please.
We have really missed you.
Yeah.
And now, my presentation is basically on the application of geoinformatics for the vulnerability reduction. And for these purposes, I have choose two location, two different geographical location. One is in mountain area, that is Himalayan region, and another is the urban ecosystem, that is obviously our lovely Kolkata region. And I will discuss the various aspects of the application or scope of the application of remote sensing, GIS, and other data, which is known as a geoinformatics, for the betterment of our human society. And this type of application are basically coincide with the vulnerability reduction. As we know, vulnerability is basically a combination of factors that put us at the risk condition. And this type of risk condition may be developed by nature or the natural phenomenon or by the human as well. So vulnerability reduction is the capacity to anticipate this type of phenomenon or this type of event which will be happening in our society, or to cope up or to resist or to recovery from this negative situation. And in this connection, we really consider the two basic parameters. One is resource availability in our society or in our geographical location, and another is our social demand. And the cost and benefit means the balance of the resource benefit or resource availability and our social demand shows our progress rate. For this purpose, I have put here three basic ways by which we can determine our goal. If our resource availability is really synchronized with our social demand of human being, then we can achieve the balanced development. But when the resource availability is more than our social demand, then the natural stuff will obviously increased. But on the other hand, if the resource availability is very, very less in consider to our social demand, then we must face crisis situation. So a natural phenomenon or man-made phenomenon can create this type of resource unavailability in our society, which can lead the crisis situation. And for the consider of the natural resources, we really faced this type of crisis situation, especially in the unnatural conditions. So we have great opportunity
to work to manage this type of crisis situation in our society. And for this consideration, we generally consider the two different segments. One is the geographical location, which is presently commonly known as space or space segment, and another is the information about the space. And we can tie or we can correlate these two segments, means space and its information, through the application of technology. And present day, we have different type of technological advancement, which is really gather or extract the information about the space or about the geographical location. And this type of technological advancements are basically photogrammetry techniques, remote sensing techniques, global positioning system, and the geographic information system. And these all four.
But one thing, please, Dr. Mafizul, I'm interrupting, and sorry for the interruption. Have you put on your video?
Video? Okay, ma'am.
Yes. Make it.
The screen is here, na?
No, we have.
Screen is here.
Chiranjan, kindly allow sir to share his screen. Chiranjan, are you here?
I don't have to allow. If that isn't his screen, it will be presented.
My screen?
No, sir. It's not available.
It's from your part, Mafizul, please.
Ma'am. Definitely. Your entire screen.
Sir, if there is some kind of problem in presentation, you can send me the presentation and I can
present. Now it's okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I have already discussed this type of relation, and our basic concern or our basic focus is the third one, which is the less amount of resource availability and high amount of societal demand, which can create the crisis situation during the any type of natural or man-made phenomenon. And for this crisis management, we have two components. One is the geographical location about the phenomenon, which is also called as a space, and the information or the data about or regarding the space. And we can link these two with the help of technology. And nowadays we have four kind of technologies to interlink all the space with its information. And these all are the photogrammetry, remote sensing, global positioning system, and geographic information system. And these all four is commonly known as geoinformatics. So geoinformatics is an umbrella term which can denote photogrammetry as well as remote sensing, as well as global positioning system and geographic information system. And now in last century, we have experienced three type of technological innovation,
First, we have experienced biotechnological innovation after the Second World War, and during the 1970s and 80s, we have nanotechnology, and at the end of 20th century, we have information technology, which is also a part of geoinformatics. It means geoinformatics is also a part of information technology. And this information technology is basically developed with the help of computing science or computer technology. And within this information technology, we have remote sensing, GPS, or GIS system. And in the GIS system, we have some input facilities as well as we have some output facilities. So GIS can bridge this type of linkages. And for the input facility, different type of data or different type of information can trigger within the field of GIS. And this all data or information can be derived from aerial photographs, that is also called, the technology is also called photogrammetry, and satellite imageries can also give us some data or the information in the form of images. GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System, can also give lot of data, and this type of data are basically longitude, latitude, and altitude, which is commonly known as X, Y, and Z. And we have huge amount of historical map, though this all historical map is in hard copy, but we can convert all these into a digital form. Once it is developed in the form of digital version, then we can take this all information into the field of GIS. And we have lot of statistical data regarding the space, and Census Department, NSSO Department can provide huge amount of data, and we can also indulge all this data with the locational attribute. And we have also other information. So this all data can be put in the field of GIS. And these all data, basically a spatial data or maybe a non-spatial data. So spatial data structure and non-spatial data structure, these two are the basically form of data structure which can develop the data infrastructure. And this data infrastructure can build the output function with the help of various type of computer languages, various type of mathematical formula, and others formulas. And at the last, we have different type of output result. Suppose we have spatial integration. Spatial integration means, it means the integration form of the various kind of data. And this type of integrated data can develop the artificial intelligence. And now we are going through the age of artificial intelligence. So the artificial intelligence can be a part of GIS. And this type of artificial network is just now starting. So we have a lot of opportunity to use artificial network in the field of GIS. And through this artificial network, we can predict the phenomenon, or we can predict our future program also, or future perspective also. And we have map infrastructure. It means GIS can provide a lot of maps. And these maps, as these all maps are developed based on the computing technology, so any branches or any branch of the science can use this type of map. So we have a lot of map opportunity which build the map infrastructure, as well as we can develop the data volume through the process of GIS. Data volume means huge amount of data matrix, because previously we have individual or segmented data, but through the help of GIS technology or through the help of mathematical formula or logic, we can create different type of association or interaction. So the association and interaction can build a huge amount of data volume, and the data volume with time can create data velocity. Now we are experiencing data velocity in our current pandemic situation, and in this pandemic situation, day by day the number is going on, and even the number is changes with the change of second of the time. So based on the temporal dimension, the huge data changes can create the data velocity, and we can prepare the big data structure, we can prepare the report also. So these all the output can use in our decision making process, and based on this decision making we can create the plan, or we can create our future program also. So GIS is providing the great opportunity to build this type of interaction spatially and non-spatially, and these all are the scientific branches which can involve for the processing of this type of geoinformatics technological development. And now, as a application side, I will show two different kind of application area. Number one is the groundwater intervention in active tectonic part of the Himalaya Uttarakhand. Nowadays the groundwater is very, very crucial natural resources in our world, because actually the potable water is very, very limited, and it is mostly confined in some geographical condition. And although we in the lower Ganga plain we live in the water surplus region, but the maximum area of our country is not the same as we are here. So in the central part, in the western part of the India, even in the Himalayan part, there is a huge water crisis. So to provide the natural resources, basically the water resources, for the human society or for the settlement area, it is a great challenging job to the planner or to the decision maker. Especially when the case is in Himalayan and central part of the Himalaya, as it is an active tectonic area and the geological characteristic or geological setup is more complex, so it is very difficult to found the groundwater for the drinking purpose or for the human settlement. And due to its complexity in geometry of the mountainous region, it is quite difficult to find the water below the surface. But if we use our technology or the geoinformatics, it means the basic information of that places along with our human demand or along with our human opportunity, then we can manage the shortfall of this type of natural resources. So the integration of geologic and the hydrogeological survey with the remote sensing data can provide the better information regarding the hydrogeomorphological setup of any difficult area. And for these purposes, I have choose a small area. Here it is the study area, which is located just 17 kilometers from the Bageshwar area. Bageshwar is a district of Uttarakhand, which is located in the central part of the Himalaya. And why this region is important? Because of the one famous and one large school has set up in this area. It is 17 kilometers from Bageshwar, and Bageshwar region is here, and it is mostly populated area. So the authority, government authority, set up one school here, and its school create a huge demand on the water resources, but the water is not easily available in this area, although the river system is also there. So this is the picture view of the school system, and this is the school playground, and we can see the flat playground in the front of the school, and behind this is a mountain range. And this school has more than 450 students, and all are in board school. It means the school is residential school. So there is a total 450 students, including male and female category, and plus there is staff quarters, which has also bear more than 150 people. So total demand is more than 600 people, create a huge water demand in daily basis. But as it is a complex region, means complex geological region, so that water availability is very, very limited. Here we can see only these two tanks, and this RO system is available for the providing the water supply in the school premises. If we found the geological setup of this Bageshwar region or of this school ground, then we can found this type of geological setup is prevailing here. Here it is located, the Bageshwar region, and in this situation, our study area means the school is located. And if we, in this geological map, we found our total study area. Jauhar School, Jauhar Navodaya Vidyalaya is located here, and the Bageshwar region is like here. And in this geological map, we found a synclinal line just the upper part of the school area. So this is the syncline line, but the ridge is also located here. It means geologically, this region is an inversion topographical region. And in this cross line section is based on this line, and this is the north southern part, and this is the northern part, and southern part is located here. So Nainital is located here, and this is the part of the Nainital. So as it is the folded mountain building, so different type of fold formation is developed in this region, along with the thrust, along with the rupture and fault. And Bageshwar region is here. See, in the Bageshwar region, there is a synclinal structure, but there is also a present high ridge. It means in this region, there is an inversion of topography. And from this folded region, we can find that this is a crystalline rock structure is developed in the surface area, which is also developed in the northern Nanda Devi portion, and which is also developed in the Someshwar portion or the below the Someshwar portion. So this crystalline portion, actually the geologist says that this crystallized portion is the nape part. So the nape or the abhav thrust is situated over this Bageshwar region, and this nape or this nape part is developed the mountainous region over the Bageshwar area. And here we can also found that the synclinal line here and this study area is developed in between two major thrust portions, in the upper part and in the lower part. So this thrust portion creates the synclinal structure. On the other hand, the nape means Almora nape creates the Almora over thrust fold, create the nape over the Bageshwar region. So it is mostly a complex geological structure in this area. And from the photographs, we can found different type of metasedimentary rocks also developed over the lower part, but the depth of metasedimentary is very, very less. It is only a 20 feet metasedimentary rock. And this also are the some crystalline rocks, which is also found in the surface portion. And this is the school building, and this school building is also wrongly developed over the thrust area. Here it is a ground thrust or ground fault is developed, and it is also found over the surface area, and the building is also developed on the thrust or on the fault region, and this fault also propagated through this direction on the hill and upper side of the hills. So there is a lots of fracture zone or lots of fault zone also, and this is the inclined nature of the crystalline rocks around or surrounding area of the school. For the investigation purpose, we have used different type of data set or different type of maps, like thematic maps of different geological structure, along with the district handbooks, aerial photos, satellite imagery, and this type of satellite imagery are basically Astradam, Sentinel-2 data, Landsat OLI data, and lastly, we did primary survey through the resistivity instrument, because these all are the secondary data source, and based on the secondary data source, what we can find that should be rectified through the field investigation or the primary survey. For these purposes, we use the resistivity survey. Later, I will discuss the activity and the process of the resistivity survey. And this is the main work field of the process which is developed from the starting. Primarily, we prepare different type of thematic map based on geological parameter, based on geomorphological parameter, and based on hydrological parameter. And then we integrated all these output through the process of geoinformatics or geographical information system software. And after that, we integrate other maps like NDVI map and normalized difference water index map with the output of this integrated value. Then we detect or demarcate the ground water zone or the probability of the groundwater zone, where we can get or where we can found the groundwater for the extraction purpose. So the validation, so after finding the probable zone of groundwater, we can prepare this geophysical survey through the resistivity meter, and finally we can prepare the output map which can detect the exact location of the groundwater or groundwater sources. For the preparation of various parameter map, we use the satellite images based on different process or based on the different methodology, and these all are the just data source or the detail of the data source. I skip this type of slides. Yeah, this is the mechanism of the resistivity survey. Actually, in resistivity survey, we prepared an instrument which can penetrate the electrical flow behind or beneath the surface, and this electrical flow can detect by the different rods or different electrodes. So the flow mechanism can develop between 2 or 3 or 4 electrodes. Based on the velocity or the interruption of this electrical flow, we can detect the material or the nature of the material below the surface. For our purpose, we have used this resistivity meter with the help of 40 electrodes. But within 40 electrodes, only 4 electrodes can be work at a time. First, number 1, number 2, number 3, and number 4. Based on these 4, the system can generate data. After generating the data, the system or instrument leave the first one and take the second one as a first station, 1, 2, 3, and next one is a 4. And in between, they create the data. And after finishing this mechanism, the third one can consider as a first electrode, and the second electrode, third and fourth, and then the third system develop the electron flow and develop the and generate the data. And like this process, the 40 electrode can combinedly generate the electron flow just beneath the ground surface. And based on the data availability, the instrument use this type of methodology, basically 3 different type of methodology for the data output. Number 1, Wehner methodology. It is used for the general profiling and the better vertical resolution. And next one is the dipole-dipole system. It is used for the better horizontal resolution. And the pole-dipole system, it is used for increasing the deeper depth information with the minimum noise factor. So, based on these 3 different methodology, data can be generated. And I will show our output also. Prior to this, I just explained the basic geological and geomorphological and hydrological condition about the earth surface, about the study area. And this is our study area, which is known as Simar basin area or watershed, because only 2 small settlements are there. One is Simar, located in this portion, and one is the Bimrari, located in this portion. And our study area is located here, in between these 2 settlement area. This is the lineament aspect of the ground surface, and this is the mineralogical composition of the surface area, and this is the structural condition of the study area, and this is the overall output of the study area, which also show the major land use or the landform features in this area. And our study area is marked here as a blue line, as a yellow line, and this is the study area. Only 2 settlements, one is Simar and one is Bimrari, is located in the 2 extreme point of the watershed area, and the school Jawahar Navoday Vidyalaya is set up here. And this is the river or small drainage system. And here we have first order to fifth order stream, and Gomti is the main river. Gomti flow from this direction to this direction. Based on this map, one can easily assume that there will be some plenty of water, but actually the water is not stored in the groundwater segment because of the high hilly topography or rug topographical nature and the steep slope nature. All the precipitated water quickly run into the Gomti River and flow from this study area. And from this map, we can find that the minimum elevation is 900 meter, whereas the maximum elevation is 1700 meter. So the relative relief is more critical in critical situation in these cases. And from the geomorphological segment, we can find different type of geomorphological attributes within a small area. Here we can find the Piedmont plain area, we can find the colluvial fan area. This is the colluvial fan area, and our study area means school is developed over the colluvial fan area, but colluvial fan is only covered the surface portion, but beneath the surface there is a crystalline rock structure, and the upper portion is mainly narrow valley or dissected hill slope or structure hill slope or escarpment slope. So this type of slope area can show the heavy gradient region. So this area is highly rugged and highly and slopy or gradient area, so that the water cannot be stored in this area. And the upper part of the small channels, there is a headward erosion pockets in the upper portion of the watershed region. And this is a ground slope area in the overall study area and its surroundings. And this is the ruggedness ratio. From this output, we can find that the most of the area has the more than 50% ruggedness ratio. It means this shows the rough or undulation surface or the high gradient nature of the surface area. And this is the sub-basin area. Here we can find total number of 10 sub-basin area is there. And out of this sub-basin area, D and E is the most important because it cover the maximum area of this region. And here one thing is most important, that is the sub-watershed E. The structure of the sub-watershed is quite abnormal in comparison to other sub-basin area. But it is quite possible in the highly tectonic or geotectonic controlled area, because this structure or this channel properties is fully controlled by the recent time or neotectonic activity. And I can request to look in this section, because this is the one of the most important portion of this study or important theme of this study area. So the bifurcation ratio, based on the bifurcation output, we can found that the subset E has the maximum share. It means it is that all the channels are bifurcated mostly. So theoretically, more bifurcation, it means it captures the maximum amount of rainfall in the upper portion and take the maximum amount of water in its lower section. So theoretically, we have the chance to get the maximum amount of water in this section where the school is located. But actually, this is not happen in the ground reality. Why it is happen, I will discuss later. In this section, we can found the overland flow and its direction. So just see here, in the sub-basin area, but the lower part of the sub-basin area E, we have north directional flow. And in the other section, we have north directional flow in various limited area only. But most of the area, it has the southern flow direction. It means the precipitated water is quickly run over the southern direction and joined in the main river and it's flow out. And this is the drainage density. Obviously, sub-basin area D has the maximum drainage density because of its number of channels area within the limited coverage area. And next is the sub-basin area E. It has also a medium type of drainage density. And in this map, we can found the overland flow. It means it shows the overland quantity of the water. As the Simar locality or Simar village area is located over the foothill portion, so it has the maximum probability to get water from overland flow as well as the leached water. So outside this Simar land, the water getting condition or water getting probability is very, very limited or is very, very less. Next is the constant of channel maintenance. It means the constant nature of the channel, means how the channel is linear. So based on this linearity of the channel, Simar portion, only the Simar portion has the highest probability to getting the water, means the surface water. Most interesting is the channel flow accumulation. This was the total flow accumulation, but this is the channel flow accumulation. Based on the channel flow accumulation, we can found the maximum probability is located in the upper part of sub-basin area E and the another part of this portion. But previously, we can found that the basin channel is going in this direction to this direction. So this is the one sub-basin area and this is the another sub-basin area. But in the calculation or condition of channel flow accumulation, it shows that the maximum water accumulated probability zone is like this portion. It means the flow which is accumulated in up to this section, it flow in the another channel area. It not flow in the same channel area. It means that when the water accumulated in this portion, the water table rises, and this rise water table can create the shortest path. And from this shortest part or from this linearity, it blows in this direction. So in this section, there is some tectonic control or tectonic factor is controlling in this situation. It means in normal day, water flows this direction to this direction, means towards the school. But in the high peak rainfall or high peak or flash flood condition, the maximum peak discharge goes in this direction. So this school portion or this portion is not getting the maximum volume or the highest amount of the precipitated rain. And this is the NDVI portion, and this NDVI portion we can found that the maximum portion is covered with the alpine vegetation species, and this is the NDWI, normalized different water index, which shows the water availability in surface as well as beneath the surface up to 10 meters. So based on this output, we can found the maximum water can be accumulated in this dark blue portion. As we see in the previous, the Simar has the highest tendency to highest accumulation water because of its foothill location or because of its comparatively low altitude location. But except this Simar settlement area, we have two another spot. And these two spots are basically located near to the school portion. One is located in the northern portion of the school, and another is located in the eastern western portion of the school. So these two spot has the maximum potentiality to bear the ground water under the surface area. Clear? So the integration of the previous output can predict or can show that this type of probability where we can get the plenty amount of water. If we overlay the final output based on our Google map, so it shows the exact location on the Google map. Otherwise, it is difficult to locate the exact point of these two pockets. So with the help of overlaid analysis, we can locate the exact location of the pockets, and the exact location of the pockets also connected with the different type of lineament. This lineament has the capacity to hold water and to bear the water after few days of the heavy rainfall. So this type of lineament concentration or this type of lineament linkage can also develop the groundwater beneath the surface area. So this is the school location, and these all are the water bearing channel, and this is the sub water shed E. In this sub water shed E, we can found the structure of the channel. It is slightly different from the other channels, and this section is highly controlled by the tectonic activity. So previously it is assumed that previously this water channel or this river channel flow in this direction directly, but after the headward erosion of this channel, it captured the upper streams, and so the river capturing in also regular phenomenon in this area. And because of this river capturing, the most of the time the water flow in this direction, but during the high pickup discharge, the water flow in the straight or in the linear way, and it flows from this channel to this channel. So this area cannot get the maximum discharge of this channel segment. Based on our thematic output or geoinformatics output, we planned to use our resistivity survey, and based on this resistivity data, we can create different type of profile below the earth surface, and from this profile we can detect the groundwater pockets or the aquifer portion. For this plan or for this program, we have select different type of cross section point. Number of first or number one cross section run in the river bed of the Gomti, and the second one is C and D, then E, F, G, H, I, J, and K, L. These all are the sectional cross sectional segment area, and where we used the resistivity survey for detect the situation of the underground condition. So here we can found the sectional cross sectional visibility or cross sectional geo visualization, and the first one is the AB section is located on the Gomti river bed, and in this section the blue color shows the concentration of water, and the brown color or deep brown color shows the concentration of hard rock segment. It means it also shows the resistivity in the Ohm unit. Maximum resistivity means maximum hardness of the rock. Clear? And the minimum resistivity, it means the rock or the segment has the softness and it has a pore space, and in between pore it bears the huge amount of water, and the water shows the minimum amount of resistivity. So blue color indicates the water availability, and the brown color shows the hardness or the primary rocks. It means the igneous rock or metasedimentary crystalline rocks. So in this section, we only found this linear arrangement of the water, and this water amount is very, very minimum, because the color shows this resistivity is only 184. It is developed because of the river bed location or river bed condition. As we run this section just along the river channel, so some surface infiltration is there, and this surface infiltration create this type of water blockage. But in the case of C and D, we have seen some water accumulation or some water storage here, but it is actually developed on the C and D, actually developed on the playground area. And this playground area, the boundary is developed with the help of guard wall. And this guard wall, it means it has a concrete fencing. And this concrete fencing can hold the infiltrated water or the precipitated water here. So it is not the groundwater, it is just the infiltrated or precipitated water which is blocked by the guard wall, because the C section, in the section C and C section, here it is the guard wall or the concrete boundary is there. So due to the development of concrete boundaries, some water accumulation is noticed in this section, but it is not permanent. After few days, it will evaporate from this portion. And the section E and F, the section E and F is run in this section. And here we also found one or two surface portion. Actually, these two is the small stream. These two is the small stream, E and F. These two is the small stream. So this stream can develop the surface portion of the water. It is not the groundwater, and it is not last for the long time. It will evaporate it or it will drain after few months. So this is not the groundwater. Only one segment of the groundwater is found here. It is the groundwater, and it is located almost 5 meters below from the surface area. And if we noticed that this groundwater pocket is located towards the F. So this groundwater location is towards the F. And in our final study, this small blue pocket is actually indicate this groundwater section or the groundwater section towards the eight, but it is very, very small pocket which is developed here in towards the F section. Towards the G and H, we have lot of hard rocks in the surface area, and there is almost negligible concentration of the water in between hard rock or the surface area. And in this section of I and J, section I and J run in this direction. I is near to the school and J is near to the orchard area. There is some apple orchard here, located here. So towards the J, there is a medium to large pocket of groundwater, which is located just 2 meters below from the surface, and it is extended up to 15 to 18 meters below the earth surface. So this groundwater is the main source of the groundwater for this school or school area. To confirm this groundwater, we have run another section which is extended from K to L. So the section number 6 or K to L is the extended part of this groundwater. And lastly, we developed this section to confirm this, to confirm this groundwater condition or this groundwater zone. Here we found this groundwater in this area, but the total extension of this area is much more. Here we can found one large groundwater aquifer which is located near 5 meters below the surface, which is exactly the same groundwater pocket, and it is extended up to the 15 meters, and the area is the horizontal extension of this area is almost 30 meters. So this groundwater location is actually shows the comparatively big spot of the final output. So we can consider this water chamber as a permanent source of the groundwater for this school and school community. And one positive thing is that just below the groundwater we have a hard rock. It means this hard rock can hold groundwater for long time. Hard rock is also in the lower part area, in also the lower area. But in the upper area, there is no groundwater, there is no hard rock. It means there is some soft rocks is there, and these soft rocks which hold the lots of porous or pore spaces. And if we consider that this is the upslope area and this is the low slope area, so gradient is developed towards the K. And based on this situation, we can conclude that if we treat this area with the help of technological development or with the help of engineering construction, we can develop different type of recharge zone over here. And based on this recharge zone, the continuous groundwater input will be run in over this area, and this recharge zone can sustain this aquifer for the long period of the time. And from this aquifer we can generate the groundwater source for the school or school use purposes. So this area means this pocket is basically detect or basically shows in the in our final output in the spot or in the pocket form, and this indicates the exact location of the groundwater, and this is the exact location of the groundwater, the large spot, and the small spot is there. And over the large spot there are some spring we can consider this spring as a recharge point. So if we develop different recharge pocket here, this recharge pocket can develop or can sustain this groundwater aquifer for the long time. And one most signature of this groundwater condition is this vegetation community. We can see the banana vegetation community is developed in this region. It is quite impossible to develop the banana tea in the normal Himalayan region because it is a signature of the wetty condition and mesophyte vegetation colony area. But in the banana tree develop in this hilly alpine region, it means it shows some indication of the groundwater availability for the long period of the throughout the years. So based on this signature, we can also monitor, primarily we can also monitor the groundwater location in the surface area of this active tectonic or the most complex geological areas. So this is our publication of this groundwater zone identification methodology. And next part of my lecture is basically for the determination of urban vulnerability, which is now going on in present situation, that is COVID-19, and the COVID-19 is now affected throughout the world. And now, based on this pandemic situation, we all become a one family. That is the COVID-19 family throughout the world, and this is going on. And the number of cases is also going up day by day. So in our this ongoing project, we try to attempt the predict the location, urban area, but localities of the urban area where the transmission will be more or will be possible. So based on the WHO report, this is the speciality of COVID-19 transmission outside China, the COVID-19 is basically the imported disease. So in a country or in a geographical area, the first case will be the imported case, and after the imported case, there will some local transmission, there will be some cluster transmission, there will be some community transmission. And in the small or island country, there are some sporadic transmission also. So this is just a basically conceptual model which can develop the transmission nature of this COVID-19 within a geographical area. In our study, we just assume that the social distancing is a parameter of some cases. It means the effectiveness of the social distancing can control by the various variability, like population density, like dilapidated residential house, and no exclusive room. It means these all factors can treat it as a root cause of the disease transmission or disease pandemic. If the population density is more, then there is some probability to more positive COVID cases. If the dilapidated household condition is there, then the COVID condition is also more positive. If there is no exclusive room, only one or only single room house, it means the social distancing is not possible. And the no social distancing, it means the high rate of infection or a high rate of transmission. Like this, main source of drinking water, it means for the purposes of drinking water, people have to go outside of their premises. In this situation, the social distancing is not possible. For this purposes, people can move outside of their houses or room, and this situation can also trigger the COVID cases. Next parameter is number of household not having latrine facility. For this purposes or for the nature call, we move if there is no facility of latrine within the house premises, then people have to move their house, and this type of human activity can also create positive cases. And these two factors can be considered as a dynamic pressure. It means based on these two parameters or these two variables, the positive cases or the COVID cases can increase dynamically. And this is the unsafe condition, that is the tap water sources. That is the tap water sources of the untreated water, for the untreated water. So tap water source for the untreated water can also be a positive factor of the COVID transmission. And these all data are available in the census website and NSSO site, official site. So from this site, we can download the data, and based on the integration or data integration or data infrastructure, we can generate the map or mapping output through the help of artificial intelligence. And here we select the four leading metro city of India to examine this type of assumption. One is Mumbai, another is Kolkata, and Delhi and Chennai. So in this four metropolitan area, we fit this all variable based on the machine learning and artificial intelligence. And based on these two methodology, we can find the most probable zone for the transmission of COVID cases or this type of infectious disease. So this is the some glimpses of this variability in the Mumbai region, and this is the some special condition of the variable in the Chennai, in the Delhi area. Delhi area, I mean, considered is the national capital territory, and here it is the New Delhi is located in the central portion, and these all are the national capital territory region. And this is our Kolkata region, and Kolkata region scenario is like this. And this is the Chennai area, and Chennai area scenario variation. Based on these all variation, we can generate this type of output. And here the dark portion or dark red portion shows the very high vulnerable zone within the urban area, and the yellow portion or yellow color portion is shows the very low probability of disease transmission. And so the yellow color shows the less urban vulnerability condition. In Kolkata, the dark portion in the central portion and the northern portion and northeastern portion is the more vulnerable. As we saw, the Belghori, the Damdam region and the Belgachia region, these two region is morely COVID effective area because of the slum location. Slum condition is also the important trigger factor of the COVID transmission. So slum location area is also shows the maximum condition of COVID transmission facility. And this is the Bhavanipur region in the central Bada Bazar and surroundings area. This area is also shows the high concentration of COVID cases. And this is the Bhavanipur and Baliganj area is also located here. So this dark portion shows the maximum or highly vulnerable portion in the Kolkata area. And in the case of Mumbai, the Dharavi portion is the most vulnerable portion, which is located in this portion. And in our model output, it is also shows that the Dharavi portion is also highly vulnerable area. Beside the Dharavi portion, there is a Baipula portion. So Baipula portion and the Kamathipura portion Baipula portion, Kamathipura portion is located in the central portion area. This portion area is also experienced the high amount of COVID cases. And in our model, it is also shows that this region is also the highly vulnerable area. In the Delhi section is the main central Delhi, also shows the high concentration. Besides the central Delhi area or New Delhi area, Nerela area, northeastern portion, this two portion is also highly vulnerable. And in the last two week, the Sero report is also shows that the central Delhi portion has the highest transmission. Apart from the central Delhi, northeastern Delhi and Sahadhara, this is also shows the maximum concentration of COVID positive cases in the Delhi and in the Delhi surroundings area. And the lowest portion, least amount of COVID cases is also noticed in the south and southwest portion. And in our cases also, southwest portion is shows the lowest amount of COVID cases in the Delhi portion. And in the Chennai portion, the maximum portion is located in the central portion area and central portion and Chennai metro and the central metro, Chennai railway station, this is located in this portion. And apart from this area, there is some scattered pocket of the high Chennai area. So this type of analysis which shows the urban vulnerability can also be developed with the help of GIS. Especially, this is the GIS integrated with artificial intelligence. It means the number of variability what we have chosen, these determine the efficiency or the effectiveness of this model output. Here in this study, we have only choose 6 parameters. If we consider the 16 number of parameters, then the model output will be more accurate. It means the deviation or error will be minimum. So this is the positive side of artificial network. But due to the constraint of data availability or due to the constraint of time, here we only consider the 6 parameter. Based on this 6 parameter, we consider this type of urban vulnerability zone. And from this output and our ground reality or the government announcement report, we regularly monitor our output so that we can prepare the better output and the minimum error. So and the this is the positive impact of lockdown, that is the improvement of air quality. In the last 3 months, our air quality has been improved quite acceptable range. And for the better analysis of air quality, we consider only the concentration of PM10. And PM10 is one of the most important pollutant material of the of the urban area. And this section or of this study, we have considered our Greater Kolkata, which is known as Kolkata metropolitan area, and this is the Kolkata corporation area, and Hooghly is slightly location in this region. And for this purpose, we consider three satellite images. One is 2nd February, which is the shows the signature of winter season, and the 21st March, just before the curfew, and the 6th April, it shows the scenario of complete lockdown situation. So in the February condition, the PM10 concentration was mainly developed on the Kolkata corporation area and its surroundings, including Salt Lake and airport region. But in the April condition, there is a low concentration of PM10 over the Kolkata core. It means Howrah, Kolkata, and New Town area. So, if we extract the last one and the first one, then we can determine the reduction of PM10 within this frame of town. Yes, it is also noticeable that this is the February mass, and this is the February mass image, and this is the March April mass image. So in our seasonality, there will be less amount of PM10 concentration in April, but the magnitude of concentration is very, very low in comparison to 2019 and 2018. So this is the final output of speciality of PM10 concentration. Here the pink color shows the increased PM10 concentration, which is found only Dankuni area, because the Dankuni and surroundings area is one of the industrial complex area, and the emergency services was active in the lockdown situation, along with the different high capability energy generation or pollution generation industrial plant. So the Dankuni region and its surroundings area only shows that increasing nature of PM10, and it is only 0.3% of the total coverage area. And the most of the area, this is the Salt Lake or Bidhan Nagar area, which shows the very high decreasing nature of PM10 concentration. And this is the Bantala region, another March 20, and another is the April 6. March 20, because of the announcement of lockdown and Janta curfew, the vehicular emission and vehicular movement has been increased with a large extent. And because of the vehicular and the other and anthropogenic activity, the one spike formed on March 20. And after that, it shows the decline nature. But due to the observation of small Diwali activity on April 5th, the concentration nature of PM10 is also high in comparison to 2019 on 5th and 6th April. And this is the Ghusuri case, Ghusuri station shows this type of nature, and the same nature we also found in the Victoria area of Kolkata. We have one spike in March 20, and the another increasing nature of the PM10 concentration around 5th and 6th April. Otherwise, it shows the declining nature. And Rabindra Bharati University area is also shows the same condition, but it is slightly synchronized with the 2019 data. And the Padma Pukur, it is located near Kona Express way of Howrah, Kona Express way of Howrah, and it shows the same situation. Here we also found the two spike. One is in the March 20, and another is in the around 5th or 6th April. So, on average, we can conclude that the lockdown situation improve our air quality to declining aerosol particles, especially the PM10 concentration in comparison to 2019 and 2018 also. So these all are the basic application site of geoinformatics along with the artificial network, satellite image interpretation or satellite image classification, and along with the other map or statistical data.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. We really enjoyed your lecture as it was fully based on the modern geographical tools that we, the users of geospatial technologies, and also you have nicely compared both the present status of COVID-19 situation all over India through geographical mapping and annotation. Sir, we have a few questions. The first question from the chat box, that how can the urban heat island affect the going to be better solved by landscape design in urban ecosystem?
Yes, nowadays urban heat island is the most burning issue in the metropolitan area, and based on the urban local climate consideration along with the urban architect, the architect and urban planners can design their building structure, building nature along with the wind corridor development. So there is a wide scope to develop this type of opportunity or this type of activity in the planning purpose of smart city generation. And in our cases in the India, all the smart city areas are basically planned towards the minimization of energy consumption and maximize the uses of natural resources like wind, like solar energy, like sunlight, for minimize the which will minimize the effect of urban heat island. But in the case of old town like Kolkata, means the central Kolkata area, or the central Delhi, or the old Mumbai area, where the population concentration and the built up concentration is very, very compact, so in this area it is difficult to design eco-friendly or to design the urban development which can minimize the effect of urban heat island. But obviously in the new town development area or the smart city program, the planner obviously use this type of objective to minimize the urban heat island and maximize the use of green space and the airy or light space area.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I have one more question. You have, some of your presentation, you have shown that the maximum bifurcation, that means that it receives the maximum rainfall from the upper part. So my question is that what amount of annual average rainfall was occur in that place?
In our study area, the average rainfall in the yearly rainfall is 150 to 200 centimeter, but in the rainy season the 90% of the precipitation is generally happen. So there if the precipitation intensity high in the rainy season, there is the minimum chance to penetrate water in the crystalline rocks.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And the final question, what are the tectonic factors controlling the discharge?
Controlling the discharge?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, discharge are mainly controlled by the tectonic factor, that is the fracture and the fault, which is very commonly found in the central part of the Himalaya, and the some hard rock intrusion or crystalline rocks intrusion, and the steep or escarpment slope, which can increase the discharge capacity of a river system.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Now we have come to the end of our one-day state-level webinar. We really enjoyed and enriched by the thoughtful lectures of both of our resource persons. On behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to convey our deepest sense of gratitude to our resource persons. Firstly, I also thankful to our principal, Dr. Seema Banerjee, whose constant help and support encouraged us to arrange the webinar. I also grateful to Dr. Shyamalina Goswami, convener, Interim Quality Assurance Cell, and convener of the webinar, and above all, our respected head, Department of Geography, Hubli Women's College, for her constant effort and overall arrangement to make a grand success to our webinar. In connection, I also try to mention the name of other faculty members of our department: Dr. Shyamapada Shatra, Associate Professor; Dr. Sujata Das, Associate Professor; Dr. Tanmay Dhiba, Assistant Professor; and myself for associated help and support to make successful of the webinar. I also thankful to Professor Shottojit Bishwas, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemistry, and Bursar of our college for financial assistance and support and valuable suggestions. I also mention the name of Professor Chiranton Hatra, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of Physics, Hooghly Women's College, for overall coordination of the webinar, for technical and overall support and assistance. And finally, we become thankful to the respected participants from different institutions for their spontaneous participation to make the webinar a grand success. Thank you all. We are concluding here with and thanking all of you. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shomita, for your overall coordination of the total things. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now this is the end.